about 9 million Sudanese people who've been displaced internally, making it the world's largest internal displacement. Now, the latest flare-up in the 20-year-long internal conflict between the Sudanese armed forces and the paramilitary group, it's called the Rapid Support Forces, it's reportedly claimed more than 12,000 lives. The International Criminal Court saying both parties are guilty of war crimes. Let's get the exact situation now as to what is going on in Sudan and whether anything can be done about it. We'll speak now to the Deputy Director at Human Rights Watch. She is Laetitia Bader. Ms. Bader, thank you very much for your time. I'd like to begin with the numbers that are being quoted here from International Organization for Migration, suggesting that some 10.7 million Sudanese were uprooted or have been uprooted from their homes in Sudan, and this includes 9 million who are displaced internally. Behind these numbers, Laetitia, are stories of trauma, stories of devastating decisions. Are you able to fill us in on what you have been hearing?
Yes, and as you say, I mean, the statistics are shocking and warrant attention in themselves. But what we are trying to highlight here is just how much behind these numbers there are stories of immense suffering. From the get-go, the two warring parties, so these are the Sudan Armed Forces and the Rapid Support Forces that were once allies, their leaders actually overthrew the transitional government in Sudan in late 2021, started fighting in Khartoum, in the capital city. This is a town of an estimated 6.5 million people at the onset of the conflict. And from the get-go, they completely showed disregard for basic laws of war. They were fighting very heavily inside the center of Khartoum. The Rapid Support Forces occupied residential areas, residential homes, in that context committed horrific abuses against civilians. And then on the other side, you had the Sudan Armed Forces, which repeatedly bombed residential areas, civilian infrastructure. The health system right now in Khartoum, which was very centralized in Sudan, has been absolutely devastated. Another terrible statistic is about 70% of the health infrastructure in Sudan has been destroyed. Now, what we're highlighting here is the internal displacement, which is now the highest in the world. But of course, there's also massive displacement into neighboring countries. Egypt, Chad has 500,000 people that arrived in Chad because of horrific abuses by the Rapid Support Forces in West Darfur. So all these are horrific stories. Many people have had to leave their loved ones behind, older people, people with disabilities, but also people who could just not afford to flee. Fleeing in this context is incredibly expensive. And so many people are also left behind. And I think what we are showing and we're seeing here as well is that people have already, within the last 10 months, had to displace multiple times. So not only leaving their homes in Khartoum, they moved to Wad Madani, which was taken over in December by the Rapid Support Forces. They're again on the run as we speak. The stories are horrible. The situation is not receiving the international or regional attention it deserves. And this is why here we're using these horrible numbers to remind the world that the action is costing lives and creating immense suffering.
Yep, and much of that attention perhaps skewed in favor of what's going on in the Middle East and at times the Russia-Ukraine conflict. Let's continue with the statistics, Laetitia, because the understanding is that over 20 million Sudanese are now at risk of severe hunger, and I suspect a large number of them, are women and children.
Yes, I mean, In terms of the displacement, I mean, we know that about 19 million children are, as we speak, out of school as a result of having been forced to flee, as a result of the impact on the civilian infrastructure. The food insecurity is another area that really would warrant much more international condemnation and action. We've been seeing both the warring parties in different ways basically violate basic international humanitarian law when it comes to allowing in aid access. There is aid getting in, but it is very limited. It is very slow. The Sudanese armed forces, along with the military intelligence in particular, have been blocking visas, have been blocking supplies. Since September, medical supplies have been prevented from getting into Khartoum. So the medical NGO Doctors Without Borders, which was one of the only international organizations still operating in Khartoum, have repeatedly said they've had to stop surgeries, notably cesareans, which was the main form of surgeries they were carrying out in Khartoum, because of these bans on supplies. Mm-hmm. So obviously that is also impacting food. What we've seen on the side of the rapid support forces in particular has been massive looting of what exists in terms of aid supplies in the country. In December, they looted an enormous warehouse of the World Food Programme in the town of Wad Madani, which was the town, again, where many people from Khartoum had fled to, hoping to find safety, security, hoping to reach assistance. And then again, we're seeing that the horrific abuses targeted against this assistance.
Yeah.
So the needs are immense.
The looting you speak about, Laetitia, it leads me to a conversation about accountability. Who should be held accountable for this immense suffering? Because there are reports of activists being targeted, widespread abuse by the RSF, including the Sudan Armed Forces. And then the one particular crime that really constantly rears its ugly head when it comes to war, and that is rape. Talk to us about who's to be held accountable here.
Both warring parties have committed very serious abuses. They have, but the abuses have differed in different contexts. You also have different dynamics within this broader war. Mm. In West Darfur, in particular, we have documented since April waves of ethnically targeted attacks by rapid support forces and allied Arab militias there. This was a state where there had already been attacks ongoing for several years now, and the world hadn't responded to those. So when it comes to West Darfur, in particular, the rapid support forces and their leadership at the highest level need to be investigated and need to be held to account for these horrific crimes. When it comes to a lot of the targeting of responders, so what we're seeing, for example, in Khartoum is that previous resistance committees, which had created themselves during the revolution against the Omar al-Bashir regime, have been transforming themselves into medical volunteers, into trying to get some sort of assistance to communities who are left inside the capital city. We've been seeing targeting by both warring parties against them. More recently, since December, we've been seeing very vocal messages more from the SAF, Sudanese government side, against these resistance committees, against activists, arrests, threats. So this is really a trend which, again, is being ignored by the international and regional community, isn't being condemned. And I think we have seen multiple opportunities, including during visits to South Africa, of the leadership of the rapid support forces, to really send much clearer messages that business as usual is not possible in a context like this. And yet we've just not seen any consequences, whether diplomatic, whether in terms of accountability, for the horrific abuses both warring parties are committing right now.
A final question to you. I mentioned earlier that the global attention at the moment is very much focused on the Hamas-Israel conflict at the moment, and much to the neglect of the people of Sudan, global inaction is obviously costing lives in Sudan, Laetitia. What are you calling for? We saw countries like my own, South Africa, going to the International Court of Justice on the Israeli-Hamas conflict, wanting to assert human rights there. What is it, or who should speak up for Sudan?
I mean, regional inaction, including by South Africa, when it comes to horrific conflicts on the region in recent years, in Ethiopia's northern region and now in Sudan, has been a problem, was a problem before Ukraine and was a problem before the Israel-Palestine conflict. But it's put in stark contrast right now with the incredibly important steps and measures which South Africa has been taking on the Palestine situation. So what is critical is that there are not double standards on the continent. The lives of Sudanese, the lives of Darfuris are as important, and the regional community needs to respond in the same way. So what would we like to see? We would like to see clear condemnation of, for example, the deliberate obstruction of humanitarian assistance, the attacks on humanitarians. We would like to see the African Union take many more concerted measures to protect civilians. Right now, as we speak, the UN mission, which had a mandate of civilian protection, it wasn't a peacekeeping force, which had been removed several years ago, but it did have that mandate, was scrapped overnight in November. And right now, no one is talking sincerely, concretely about civilian protections. And we're now seeing the cost of that. So it's critical for South Africa to lead really efforts as well on the continent to make clear that accountability for crimes on the continent are as important.
Laetitia, let me thank you very much for your time. Laetitia Bader is the Deputy Director at Africa Division, and more specifically with the Human Rights Watch. It is a terrible situation unfolding in Sudan, and has been, as Laetitia mentions, before the Russia-Ukraine conflict and before what we are seeing to be the latest conflict in Gaza.